All right, let's welcome in our Fox 4 film critic, Mr. Sean Edwards, celebrating the end of 2020 with a look back at the best movies of the year.
You brought your top five for us. Let's start with number five.
Yeah, we'll start with number five on my list. And let me say this real quick. 2020 was not a good year for a lot of people. It was actually an excellent year for the movies. Number one, more people have more time than ever to watch content. So that's always a good thing. It was also a great year for small independent movies because a lot of the big blockbuster movies got moved to 2021. That's a good thing as well. And there were also a lot of movies directed by women and people of color, which is also a very good thing. So I'll start with number five on my list, Palm Springs, starring Adam Sandberg. And it's like this generation's Groundhog Day, except it was actually better. There's this couple who meet at a wedding and they get stuck in this infinite time loop and they start living the same day over and over again. It's an indie rom-com that had a lot of heart, had more than a few original moments. It was actually the love story of our times because we were all actually living on our own infinite time loop. So it's wacky, courageous, and pandemic fresh. So that's number five on my list.
I want to see that.
That's cool.
It's fun, funny, refreshing. I know Abby Eden was asking for a movie she just wanted to sit back and watch earlier in the eight. Palm Springs. I don't know what Russ was talking about with that Tom Hanks movie. Are you seriously? You want something fun like Palm Springs or Wonder Woman? Come on now.
All right, number four.
Yeah, number four, Miss Juneteenth. And it's timely, but not for the reasons you may think. I know Juneteenth became a big issue this June because of a certain set of circumstances, but this small indie film had a lot of big ideas. It talked about relevant issues like Black business ownership, historically Black colleges, the challenges of poverty, Black pageant life, and it did it without being fussy. More importantly, it laid out the historical significance of Juneteenth, which a lot of people sadly did not know about. And also the lead, Nicole Beharie. She's criminally underrated. She delivered the performance of the year. Just a fantastic small little movie, Miss Juneteenth. Now, number three on my list is a movie that's been stuck in my head since I watched it like several weeks ago. It's called Promising Young Woman. It's much more than a feminist revenge thriller, but this film cuts like a knife. It's a smart Black comedy that often stings with this potent message on toxic masculinity. It's provocative and unsettling, but it's also oddly insightful. Carey Mulligan, who stars, delivers the best performance of her career in this ruthlessly executed Me Too era masterpiece, Promising Young Woman, number three on the list. All right, now number two on the list. This is another one Abby may want to check out, or anybody may want to check out, because it's just an easy, fun watch. It's called Sylvie's Love, and it's a nostalgic romantic movie that perfectly takes its cues from some of the classic American romantic films of the mid-1960s. It stars Tessa Thompson and Nnamdi Asomugha, who are terrific and excel in this perfectly executed and gorgeously looking film. And then finally, number one on my list, and this one's tricky because the number one spot is going to Small Axe. And yes, Small Axe is an anthology, but each of these five films directed by Steve McQueen could occupy the top spot on my list. They're all that good. And first off, who drops five movies all at once? I guess Steve McQueen does. And secondly, how are each of these so breathtakingly different, urgently important, and culturally poignant? There are five different movies, all streaming on Amazon. Just a truly masterful piece of work, and they all deserve the recognition. So I collectively put all five at number one.
Wow.
That's amazing piece of work.
Hey, Sean, we were chatting with you a little bit earlier. You were just featured in an article in Pitch. And one of the questions that was asked of you is where you learned your love of movies and how you got your start. Why don't you share that with us? Come on now.
Well, I learned my love of movies. I got it from my mama. I mean, my mom, we used to go to the movies every weekend when I was a kid. And then one day I just turned to her and said, this is really cool. I love movies. And, you know, my mom was an educator. She was a teacher. So I asked her, how do people make movies? And, you know, anybody knows who has a parent for a teacher, you're never going to get the answer. So she threw me in the back of the car. You know, this is pre-car seat era. So she threw me in the back of the car. I don't even think we wore seatbelts back in the day. And that's how old I am. But she threw me in the back of the car and took me to the Plaza Library. And I checked out a bunch of books on how to make movies. And it all began there. And then I bought my first Super 8mm camera at the old Clicks camera store in Brickside.
Yep.
Across the street from the old movie theater, which is now a Price Chopper. And just started shooting film. And it took off from there.
Hey, we got to go. We'll see you in the new year. Happy New Year, buddy.
Happy New Year,
man. Happy New Year, Sean.
You're legendary.